Hello, this video will be covering color slash palette editing for the Rivals 2 playtests. For this guide, I'll be using Flute here as an example to go from this to this. The process is simple, but it can be a little tedious, so let's go ahead and get started. For starters, there's a couple things you'll need to grab. The necessary tools for this guide will be any version of the Rivals 2 playtest, FModel, to read and extract the palette files with, UAssetGUI to edit and save the palette files, and UnrealPak to package your edited files for the game to read. Relevant links will be in the description below. And while it isn't necessary, you can also grab Blender to open the character scenes I've created, which may help you in making or previewing your custom colors. For more info on that, skip ahead to the timestamp on screen, or use the chapters feature to skip to that section. To get us started, let's go ahead and open FModel. I've already used FModel in the past, so I'm not prompted for anything, but you may get a splash screen asking about games or directories. If not, go to the top left of the window, select Directory, then Selector. From here, you'll have some options, but these are mostly for other games or configuring custom directories for games not listed here. Either way, click the double arrow icon below Add Undetected Game to extend the window and reveal two more boxes. In the name area, you can enter whatever, but for convenience's sake, simply enter Rivals 2 Playtest. Then, click the triple dots in between the directory box and blue plus sign, which should open a window to select a folder. From here, go to wherever you installed the Rivals 2 Playtest. If you're not sure where this folder is, go to your Steam library, right-click the playtest in the list, then click on Browse Local Files from the Manage tab. This should open a window displaying where you installed the game and its files. After that, click the blue plus sign to add it to your list of games. It should automatically update the list and change it to your newly added configuration. Before you click OK, make sure to click on the drop-down menu for UE versions and change it to Game UE 5.3, as Rivals 2 is running on Unreal Engine 5.3. Once you click OK, FModel should ask to restart. Click OK and wait for the program to open itself again. You should now see Rivals 2 Windows.pack in the archives list on the left. Next, you'll need to tell FModel to load the mappings file for the game, otherwise most assets will fail to load or export properly. There's many ways to get the mappings file for the game, but I've provided a mappings file for you in the description below. Once you have the mapping file, navigate to the top toolbar and click Settings. It should default to the General tab, but if not, move to that tab. Near the bottom of the available options, you should see a checkbox appear for a local mapping file. Click it to enable the option, and you should see an option for mapping file path appear. Click the triple dots to the right of it, and select the mappings.us map file you downloaded earlier. FModel usually won't need to restart for this, so you can go ahead and open the Rivals 2 pack from the archives list now, or do so after FModel restarts if it needed to. Once you open the file, you should see the folders list appear. From the Rivals 2 folder, navigate all the way to the characters folder, then open the folder of whichever character you want to edit. In this case, we'll open Fleets. Currently, she has no skins in the playtest, but that may change in future tests. So for now, go to Skins, Default. You should see a bunch of folders from here, but you'll want to navigate to the Data folder in particular. Double-click the folder to view the packages inside, or click the Packages tab toward the top of the list. The list should now populate with all the files inside of the folder. The main files to pay attention to are the files prefixed with PE and PS, which are responsible for each palette's effect colors and character colors, respectively. For now, ignore the PE files and open one of the PS files instead. You can do this by double-clicking the file or right-clicking and clicking Extract a New Tab. The window on the right should populate with the text contents of the file, where you should see a couple of named values, primarily those you can edit the colors of. Keep in mind that the values here are stored as a value between 0 to 1 in linear RGB. Once you've decided which palette you want to edit, right-click the file from the list on the left and extract raw data. The console towards the bottom should say it exported successfully, as well as which file you extracted. If you click on the highlighted file name, it should open the file explorer directly where it extracted to. You should now have a UAsset and UXP file for whichever palette's color file you exported. If you want to edit the effect colors later, I'd suggest exporting the PE file from the same palette as well. Don't close FModel yet, but minimize it or put it aside for later. Next, open UAssetGUI, which will be used to edit the files FModel just exported. Keep in mind, this tool hasn't been updated for UE 5.3 to my knowledge, but it works well enough. When you open the program, you'll see in the top right corner that it'll say No Mappings and Unknown. Click on the drop-down menu for Unknown to show a list of available UE versions. Again, 5.3 hasn't been added to this program yet, but 5.2 will suffice, so set it to that. Next, to the left of the toolbar, click on Utils to reveal the Import Mappings option. Just like with FModel, go to wherever you downloaded the mappings file for Rivals 2 and select it. Once you do so, the No Mappings box should change to say Mappings. Now, you can open the file you exported from earlier. Click on File in the toolbar, then Open. Navigate to the folder you exported the files to, then select the UAsset file for the palette you're editing. You may get a warning or error, but just click OK and continue if you do. You should see a list of data on the left and detailed information for the selected data on the right. For now, go to Export Data and expand the tree. You should see Export 1 and Export 2, followed by the name of the files. Ignore Export 1 and open the tree for Export 2. Keep expanding the tree until you see Custom Color Slot Definitions, followed by a number. Once you expand this tree, you should see a bunch of them appear, usually with a number of 2. If you click on one, you'll see the detailed info on the right populate with the properties for that specific one. In the top value section, you should see the name of whichever part of the body you're coloring. In this case, body would refer to Fleet's main fur color. Knowing this, if you expand the tree for the selected property, you should see value 1. Click on this and you should see a preview of the color, along with its color values. The values go in order of red, green, blue, and alpha. Before you edit these values, keep 4 things in mind. Unreal Engine uses linear RGB for its color values in a range from 0 to 1, not 0 to 100 or 255. Values higher than 1 or lower than 0 will just overbrighten or overdarken the colors unnecessarily. On that same note, the in-game shaders tend to brighten and saturate the colors on their own, so I'd advise keeping the values generally under 0.5 to 0.7, unless you either want a very bright or saturated color, or are leaning heavily into a single color. Some darker colors stay as low as 0.03 or 0.04. Since the program isn't up to date for UE 5.3, the file may get corrupted as you edit it. To prevent yourself from losing progress, save often. I personally save every time I'm done editing a color, both as a precaution and because it has the side effect of updating the color preview to the left of the values. And lastly, UAssetGUI lists the colors twice. FModel will always have the full list of editable colors in a character's palette file, so anything past the last entry is a repeat that doesn't need to be edited. They'll already have been updated to reflect the changes you made to the original entries anyway. In Fleet's case, the very last entry in her character palette file is wood, so I'd be stopping there. So from here, edit the colors to your heart's content. If you already have colors in mind, then you can use any site or calculator of your choice to convert the values. However, make sure you're converting them to linear RGB, which is what Unreal Engine expects. I personally use this sRGB to linear site converter, which can take hex values as input. A link to this site will be in the description below. Also, I strongly recommend rounding up said converted values to the nearest millionth or sixth decimal. Anyway, once you're all done, save the file, and you can either close the program or leave it open in case you want to edit anything after you test. Now, go to where you downloaded UnrealPak. Create a folder for your mod here and name it whatever you want. The mod file will need to have underscore p suffix to its name later, but you can save time by just adding it to the end of your folder name now. From here, refer back to FModel. If you still have the packages list open from earlier, you should see the file path of the folder that the packages are in just above the listing. You want to mimic this folder structure in your mod folder. Once you've done that, place the UAsset and UXP files in the data folder. Now, drag your mod folder onto the batch file named UnrealPak with compression. Make sure you don't accidentally drag it onto the one without compression. Once it finishes, you should get a pack file with the name of your mod folder. Copy or cut the pack file, then go to the installation folder for Rivals 2. Navigate to Rivals 2, Content, Packs, and make a folder named Mods here. Then paste your mod in the folder. After that, launch the game. If everything went well, once you load into a match with the character and palette you edited, you should now see it in-game. If everything looks okay, then you're done. If some things are too bright or the wrong color, you can go back to UAssetGUI to reopen the palette file and make any changes you might need to make, then repeat the packaging process until you get it the way you want. And that should cover everything. Thank you for stopping by. Hopefully this guide provides enough to actually walk you through the process properly. If there's anything I missed, or any improvements I could make in the future, don't hesitate to let me know. The rest of this video will cover some extra but optional steps regarding the Blender scenes I mentioned earlier in the video, so feel free to stop here if you're not interested or already skipped to it. In an attempt to make color editing less of a blind shot in the dark, I've made some Blender scenes to help preview things. Huge shoutouts to Cho for helping me to significantly improve these scenes though. They're great at what they do and give me a much nicer template to work with. Thanks again for the huge help on this. That being said, there are three caveats to keep in mind with these Blender scenes. 1, you'll still have to convert the color values to linear RGB on your own. 2, the colors aren't exactly accurate with the game shaders, especially for more complex effects like Rano's Sash, Loxodon's Magma Coating, or Claren's Sword. 3, certain objects that are colorable but aren't present on the character aren't in these scenes. The only occurrence of this that I know about as of recording is one of Maple's vine colors, however. With that out of the way, this section will cover what to expect in these Blender scenes and how to generally navigate them. A download link to the Blender files will also be in the description below. When you first open any of the Blender scenes, labeled with their respective character's name, you should end up with this layout. The top left area will show the character themselves, while the top right will show the camera setup. The left viewport will likely be set to solid mode, displaying the character in gray. To properly display the materials, go to the viewport shading modes and switch to rendered, the utmost right option. The bottom window should show the shader editor, where you can edit the materials from. Further to the right, you should have the standard scene outliner on the top and the properties panel below that. Since the main focus for these files is to simply edit the colors, the shader editor should be set to display a node group by default containing all the colors you can normally edit. If you click on the character skeleton or any of the parts responsible for the camera and light setup, the shader editor may become blank. To get back to where you were, click on the model again in either viewport, which should display the material nodes again, then hold the middle mouse button in the shader editor and move around until you see the color node group, usually towards the top of the node setup. As it states in the shader, click on the node group, press tab on your keyboard, and you should see all the color nodes again. Most of these will be mixed nodes with colors corresponding to their respective part, but some parts may have a color ramp or RGB node instead. Regardless, all of them can be changed by clicking the box containing the preview of that color and adjusting the values manually or by using the color wheel. Color ramps often use the element colors in the PE files for a character, so you may have to edit those as well depending on the character you're making a color for. I've labeled each node with the respective names of the parts they belong to as named in their PE or PS files. These scenes aren't perfect by any means, but they should serve as a good starting point for making the palette the way you want. Once you're finished with your colors in Blender, use any site or calculator of your choice to convert the values to linear RGB, which is what Unreal Engine expects. I personally use this sRGB to linear site converter, which can convert the hex values Blender provides. The link to this site will be available in the description below. If you skipped ahead to this segment, now would be a good time to go back to where you left off. But otherwise, that's the end of the video. Catch you later.